Welcome all of you. Any issues? What happened to others? Only 47 are here. Okay. So as I have told, this is one of the most fundamental subject in computer science course. Let's see in some more detail. Like, we all will be dealing with data in a day-to-day life in many places as human beings. Like that, computers all deals with data in many places. So let's see some of the examples. Let's take the example of a language dictionary. In a language dictionary, the data is a list of, a minimum we can say a list of words. And maybe its synonyms, its meaning, etc. will also be there. In a dictionary, the list of words will be arranged in a sorted order, in alphabet alphabetically sorted order. One second. So that will enable you to search for a particular word very fast or in an efficient manner. What about if you have a dictionary and the dictionary does not have words arranged in this order, like it is not in the sorted order, it is randomly arranged, then it's of no use, isn't it? We may not be able to search for a word in an efficient manner. That's it, isn't it? So here the data is a list of words or a list of strings or a list of what you call names, something like that. So a list of text. So that is one example. See another example. This is okay. So let's see another example. This is the map of a city. So here there are a lot many landmarks were given, like this is an airport, this is some cultural center, this is some church, etc. So this is a specific type of data or a data about a city. And this, for the efficient use of this particular data, we need to store the data in a particular manner, isn't it? So here landmarks will be pointed, then there will be paths from one place to another, like routes from one place to another. So you may be asking about in Google and all, you can see that you can ask for a shortest path from shortest route from one place to another. So that sort of usage will be applicable for such a data. So in order to enable that sort of usage, we will have to store or organize this data in that particular manner, so that here the landmarks or the places should be arranged in some manner, the route should be arranged in another, etc. So what I'm trying to say is this is some type of a data, and this they need to be stored and organized in some manner. This is another example of a account statement, where we have something like data like previous balance, then this is the bill payment. So there will be some reference number, then debits and credits, then balance, and so many things. So an account statement. So we all know that this need to be stored in a or organized in a tabular format, so that at the end of the day, somebody may ask what is the average withdrawal per week. or what is the total deficit a month, and so on. So in order to aggregate all this, in order to aggregate the details of this data, we need to have, we need to organize this data in a, in some manner. Instead of you can store it in date order, you can store it in reference number order or whatever. But we know that this need to be stored in a tabular format, so in a like a table, so that the usage will be easy. So that's all. That's about an intro towards some of the data which we are usually deal with. So computers also deal with a lot of data, maybe more data than what we deal day by day. So computers also require data need to be organized in some manner. For each data, it requires in it to be stored or organized in different ways, so that the usage is efficient. Right. So that the basic definition for this is the basic definition for a data structure. Data structure is a way to store and organize data in a computer so that it can be used efficiently. So there comes the definition of data structure. We have in a computer, we would like to store a huge amount of data, and we would like to use it so that the for the efficient use of this data, we need to organize the data in a particular manner, so that the way we are going to store and organize the data in a computer is called a data structure. So different data will be stored in different data will be stored in different Excuse me, are you able to hear? Hello?
Yes, sir, we can hear.
Okay. Okay, thanks. So as I've told, data structure is a way to store and organize data in a computer so that it can be used efficiently. Right. We talk about data structures as today we'll have just a feel of a data structure. Then we will try to go back and try to learn the things in a much more deeper way. Like today we'll take some of the examples and we'll take we'll see what we are exactly going to learn through our syllabus. And then we'll wind up. Okay. So we talk about data structures as in two ways. Like one way is as a mathematical or a large model, or in a very higher level, we call it usually an abstract view. Then the common name given to it, an abstract data type. The other way which we talk about data structures as it's implementation view. Implementation will be usually done with the help of a programming language like C. We are going to use C programming language for our lab exercise and for our theory assignments or examples as well. Okay. So a mathematical or a logical model is a bit higher level view, where it's also called an abstract data type. For example, let's take the example of a television. what is an abstract view of television? A television is something which can be turned on or off. It can receive signals. It can have audio output and video output and so many other things. That's the mathematical or logical model of the term, the entity television, right? So when the underlying electronic what you call things like electronic the board or the connections etc. will be will not be discussed. That comes part of the implementation. This is the higher or abstract view of a television. So from our viewpoint, we'll take the example of a list. We usually come across this data type or this data structure, more specifically list data structure. List as an abstract data type, we have seen it in the case of what you call language dictionary. Dictionary is a list of words, isn't it? So a list as an data type, it can store a given number of elements of any type. Like if you're talking about a list of integers, we can store some number of integers. Read elements by position. The elements are stored. The elements are stored in some way, and you should be able to read elements at first position, second position, and so on. You should be able to modify element at position. So that comes as part of the list abstract data type. You can directly relate the list data abstract data type to its implementation as arrays in any programming language. Arrays in C is a concrete implementation of a list data structure, list abstract data type. So as I've told, abstract the data structures can be defined as viewed as two. One is abstract data type and concrete data type. Abstract data type is the abstract view of a data structure, and concrete data type is the implementation view of a. So list, as I have given here, list as these three points is the abstract data type. List as an array is its implementation. Any questions? So from the previous example data type, the implementation you can directly relate as you all know it, the implementation, concrete implementation of a list data structure is as an array. Another implementation of a list data structure is linked, and those who know Python, there is a list data type, it's linked list. Don't worry about linked list, we'll be talking about linked list much more. So let's try to define an abstract data type. An abstract data type is it defines data and operations, but there is no implementations. That is what abstract data type. So in an abstract data type, we'll be defining what type of data we are going to store and organize, and what are the possible operations on the that particular data type. So it defines a logical view. It defines the type of operation, and more preferably, it defines the cost of operations also. What do you mean by the cost of operation? The cost of operation is the time and space taken for each operation. Or let's take the simplest way, like you have a list data structure, and the list data structure you would like to access a particular element at a position. How much time it takes for accessing that element? Or you would like to modify an element in a particular position, well, how much time it will take? The time will be usually in our case, the time we usually are not going to discuss it in terms of seconds, milliseconds, or microseconds. We have to discuss it in terms of a function. or we can define time as a running time or execution time in the case of implementation, but in case of abstract data type we need to discuss it as in a more higher level, like in a higher level view, how much it will be defined as a function, it will be defined as a function of the input. We will see it more detail. So we'll be thinking about more data structures like arrays, linked list, stack, queues, tree, graph, etc. And throughout the syllabus we'll be talking about all these data structures, and these data structures will be discussed both in the abstract view and in its implementation view as well. Here array, linked list, stack, queue all are linear in structure, and tree, graph, etc. are non-linear in structure. Any questions so far? Let's hook on to more on to the list abstract data type. As we have told, list ADT or abstract data type is we have defined it like this: store a number of elements of a given type, write, modify position, read elements at position, etc. So you directly can correlate these statements to an array. So you in C programming language you can define it like this: as an integer array of 10 elements, you write or modify elements at position A of 0 equal to first element. Your first element is changed. You read element at position A of I, where I is some other index. So you can directly correlate the list ADT to an array. So this is the case of a a static list. Like you created a list for 10 integers, and that 10 integers are stored as it is, and you are not going to increase the number of elements in the list. What about we will see it in a bit more higher level, or a bit we'll extend our list data structure such a way that let's say we are going to create a dynamic list. So now this list is a dynamic D-list. A D-list ADT. Say initially we have created a list with a size 0. So empty list means that you don't have any element. You create an element means you insert an element. You remove an element. You can count the number of elements. Then the other operation, read and modify elements at position. With this was already there in the static list, specify data type also. Okay, so this is compared to the previous list. This is having a bit more, or it's an extension of the previous thing. Here we will be creating the list as with elements 0 or an empty list. Then we'll be inserting elements one by one. Remove, if you would like to remove an element, you can remove and so on. So the list will be dynamic. This list is going to grow dynamically. What I'm trying to say is I'm trying to define a list abstract data type, which is a dynamic entity. Okay, which is not just like an array implementation, array which we were talking about in the previous slide. In this case, the array is this is a static list. So let's say you have created an array once again A with some number of positions, and we have defined a variable called max size, and you create this array. You create a variable n is equal to -1, which means that your list is empty, and this corresponds to this. Insert, you create a function for inserting. You insert 4, it was inserted at position here at the 0th position. Insert 4, you inserted at position second position. So this is a dynamic list where you say that the insert function is what you can this is just I'm trying to give you a hint towards what we are going to do in the rest of the semester. So So this is just a presentation. You just look at the in that view. Okay. So this is not a different data structure. You have a dynamic list, and you created the list with zero elements. You didn't have any elements in this list. You had a list with max some positions only. Then you created this int n equal to -1, means that your end was pointing to this position. This is your zeroth position. This is your first position, second position, and so on. So once you insert an element, your end will be pointing to this will be pointing to the position. Okay. Next, you call another insert. Your end will be pointing to. So always the end will be pointing to the last position in the list. And once again, you place an insert 6. It will be inserting a new element here. Position to insert this is another insert operation. Insert 5, 2, insert 5 at space 2 at position 2. This is the zeroth position, first position, second position. Sorry, the 5 should be here. So insert 5 at this position. So this will be replaced with 5 and so on. Remove zero means you'll be removing this element. So that sort of a list. What will happen if we have crossed this size? Like so what we have done is we have created a list with some max size, and this size, let's say this size was some 10 elements. What will happen if we have all inserted all the 10 elements? Then the list is full. I'm not saying that this is an array, this entire list is full. I'm talking about a dynamic list abstract data type. Yeah, once again, if you ask for an insert, then it will say that you are not supposed to insert because your list is already full, isn't it? So in that case, when an array is full, what you have to do is you have to create a new larger array, then copy all the previous elements into the new array. That's the only option, isn't it? So with this implementation, with this static sort of array implementation, what you'll have to do is to dispose this array, and you create a new array with larger size and copy all the elements, so that the next time onwards you give an insert operation, it will be inserted onto the new a new array with position. So once you have copied all the previous array elements into the new array, you need to free memory for the previous array. So you dispose this array and copy the previous elements to the new array. Now let's quickly see the time taken for all these operations also. See, for accessing an element means read write element at an index. You know the particular position. Let's say I am going to read A of 3. A3 is this position, A of 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. So A of 3 is 7. So we know the position. A of 3, you ask for A of 3 to the system, then the system will give you an address. This value will be stored in some address in empire. The value will be stored in some address. Address will be given directly. So it is going to take only constant time. We say that it is order of one time. So don't worry about this order of one time and all. It's constant time. It's not depending upon the number of elements that's currently present in the list. So this is how we represent the time taken for accessing the elements in the data structure or for any operation in the data structure. So as a function of the number of elements in the list. So let's say an insert operation. You would like to insert a new element. Insert a new element. If you have let's say for inserting a new element, you have to look through the free position. Let's say our implementation was our data structure was defined like that. Then you ask whether it is possible to insert here, etc. Then you say that, yeah, here there is a vacant position, you insert there. Then it's going to take order of n time, where n is the number of elements in the list. What about in remove operation? The remove operation is also same. Remove operation means, yeah, let's say you would like to remove this element. Once you remove this element, you need to copy this element back to this position, then the element back to the next position, and so on. So that sort of copying will be there. So if you're going to remove this element, you need to copy all the elements to the previous position, so that the next onwards you ask for a of zero, your element should be this second element should be the access. So for removing also it is order of n. For adding, insert is for inserting at the last position. For adding means, let's say you are already on the full position, that is all the elements are, there is no vacant position in your array, you would like to create a new array, then also it is going to take order of n. So I have just today for just to have a feel of a data structure, how a data structure will look like in the abstract view. Don't worry about that if you didn't understand the things properly. So an abstract data type will be like this. You will be defining what sort of data. Here in this case, you are going to store integer data. Then the possible operations. These are the possible operations, and then the time taken or the cost of each of the operation. So usually the cost of operation will be specified in terms of time. We'll talk about computer science or data structure terms, it is called the time complexity of the operation. Time complexity. So insert is having a time complexity of order of n, remove is having a time complexity of order of n, and so on. We will talk about space complexity as well, how much space it is going to occupy in memory, how much additional space. We will see that in later. Okay. So that's about an introduction towards data structures. So as we have seen, data structures are used to process data and arrange data in different formats for many different applications. So you would like to store some data and organize the data so that you would like to use it in many different applications. So in order to design and develop a software application, you will have to organize and process the data. So for efficient usage, you will have to store it in a proper manner. Otherwise, your resources will not be used efficiently. The most commonly performed operation on data structures are traversing through the data structure, searching through the data structure, inserting, deleting, then a few other operations like merging, sorting, etc. So through the semester, we'll be talking about different data structures, and along with each of these data structure, we'll be discussing what is the traversal operation, what is the search, what is the insert, delete. Then how we are going to combine the two data structures into one, two data structures of the same type into one, how to sort the elements in the list, in the data structure, and so on. So these are the most commonly performed operations which we'll be discussing. So CSP201 data structures, these are those outcomes. So you can see that almost all the there are six course outcomes. So you can design an algorithm for a computational task and calculate the time and space complexities of that algorithm. This almost refers to the first module of the syllabus. Then you identify the suitable data structure. You can see that almost all the course outcomes having the cognitive level apply and or higher cognitive level, analyze, apply, etc. So all the course outcomes are at a higher level. let's briefly look through the syllabus of our course. Module 1 is going to discuss about the basic concept of data structures like algorithms, the performance analysis of an algorithm, phase complexity, time complexity, as I've told, asymptotic notations, that's what we have just seen, the big O notation, big O, order of 1, order of n, etc. Then complexity calculation of very simple algorithms. Searching or sorting, that sort of simple algorithms, complexity calculations, how much time it's going to take, how much space it is going to take, and so on. And there is an additional topic called system life cycle, the life cycle of a program or an algorithm. That's what we'll be discussing in the system life cycle. Module 2. This is very familiar for you, Module 2. We'll be discussing about arrays and searching. We'll discuss about polynomial representation using arrays. Then sparse matrix, stacks and queues. Then a variety of queues like circular queue, priority queue, double-ended queues, etc. Then conversion of expressions. You have infix expression, postfix expression, like for example this expression a plus b, sorry, this is called an infix expression. In computers usually this expression is written as a b plus. This notation is called the postfix expression. So how we can use or how we can convert, if you're given with an expression like this, you're given a mathematical expression like this into this by using stacks. This is an application of the data structure stack. And if you're given with an expression like this, how to evaluate that expression. So conversion and evaluation. And these two topics are already familiar for you, like linear search and data, binary search. You're given with a list ADT. Or a list implementation, you implement linear search or binary search. I think you're familiar with both these terms, linear search and binary search. So in the next class onwards, we'll be starting from this module, the second module, because we'll have to start our lab exercises as well. So our first 3 lab programs are based on these 3 topics: polynomial representation using arrays, sparse matrix, and stacks and queues. Clearly, stacks and queues. So these 4 topics. So I'll be covering these topics in the beginning before the algorithms part. And with that, I'll give you a lecture on just a review of what you call arrays, then what all things you require, a review of arrays, and then structures, pointers, etc. I'll give a lecture on arrays, pointers, and structures. After that, we'll start directly from here, polynomial representation using arrays. And in the third module, we have linked list and memory management. Self-referential structures, that's the topic. Then how we allocate dynamic memory. I think you know this dynamic memory allocation. You have seen this in your previous semester. Then singly linked list, operation on linked list, doubly linked list, circular linked list, etc. So these are the so these two are the core topics in this module: singly linked list, operation on singly linked list, doubly linked list, and its operations. The rest of the things are its implementations, like two things are its implementations, like polynomial represent using linked list, then stack using linked list, queues using linked list. So in the previous module, we have seen stacks and queues using and polynomial representation using arrays. The same thing will be implemented using linked list also. Then as this one memory deallocation, this is memory allocation, memory deallocation, then memory allocation different schemes, first fit, best fit and worst fit. Then in the fourth module we'll be talking about nonlinear data structures, trees and graphs. Tree is another data structure in a nonlinear data structure. So you will be talking about binary trees, then tree traversal, then this is another core topic, binary search tree and binary search tree operations. We have all the implementation and we have all the lab programs also for implementing. Then we have a topic on graph, representation of graph, depth first, breadth first search, then application of graph. That is what we have seen in the very beginning, that is map of a city. Usually it is it can be represented as a graph data structure. And the fifth module is talking about sorting and hashing operation. Different sorting operations will be discussed, like selection sort, insertion sort, skip sort, merge sort, heap sort, etc. And different hashing techniques also. Different hashing techniques like mid square division method, folding, etc. Folding and digit analysis method. So these are the hashing functions which we'll be discussing. Then an important topic on hashing is collision resolution. If there is a collision, how you are going to resolve it? Sorting techniques and hashing, that is the fifth module. So that's all about our introduction class. Any questions so far? No questions? Okay. So our we'll be having I'll create a Moodle page for you. I think all of you have Moodle IDs, and if you are not remembering your Moodle IDs and passwords, you collect it and keep it with you. I'll be creating a Moodle page for our data structures lab. Then the data structures lab programs need to be completed and uploaded in the Moodle page. Then time and date and time restrictions will be there for completing and uploading your lab experiments in Moodle. And there will be frequent Moodle quizzes, which will be treated as your viewer for your lab exercises. And for your data structures theory subject, you will be having assignments that also will be need to be uploaded in the corresponding page. You will be having programming assignments. So programming assignments need to be uploaded in such a way that program and its corresponding screenshot of the output. Any questions? So that's all for today. The next class will have a review of arrays, structures and pointers, which will be a recorded video. I'll be uploading the video on to YouTube, and I'll be sharing the link to you. So tomorrow morning 8:30 class, you watch the video, and if you have any problem, you come with your doubts in the next class. Okay, thank you. Any questions? If you have any questions, specific questions, you can ask now. Or anything to clarify, any. or any clarification, anything? Yeah, C programming language is necessary because it's mentioned in the syllabus. In the syllabus, it is mentioned as C programming language, and the operating system is also mentioned as Linux operating system. So you'll have to use Linux operating system and C program and C language, and GCC compiler need to be used. We will follow the conditions set by the university. Anything else? Notes? No, usually I won't be giving any notes for this recording. Yeah, every class will be recorded, and the recorded video will be given to you, will be available to you. I'll download this video and try to upload it in YouTube and send it to you, the link. Okay. I'll not be giving a notes for you. So if at all you require notes, you'll have to prepare it yourself. I'll share my slides with you. Whatever slides I have, slides will be sent to you. But I think I'll upload all this in the Moodle page so that you can download it from there. Any other questions? Yeah, okay, I know. Some people are not able to join the video. Roll number 17. Okay. Okay then, thank you. So Linux is not essential, right? Linux is mentioned in the syllabus. Linux is you can look, you can go through your syllabus, and that syllabus, in the syllabus it is mentioned as operating system is Linux. Compiler need to be used as GCC. It is mentioned. But GCC compiler can be used in Windows also. Like if you have any you can use GCC in Windows for time being. That also will be okay. You can download something like MinGW. I'll type it here, MinGW for Windows. And using that, I can download GCC through that, and you can use GCC there, and that can be integrated with Visual Studio Code also. Visual Studio Code. Use MinGW for Windows. Download GCC there. You integrate it with Visual Studio Code so that the C program can be run in Visual Studio Code. Or any other IDE. Okay. Okay then, thank you.